Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Everybody ready? You ready? Is he ready?
Yes, we're ready.
All right. Everybody good?
Thank you so much.
You're 27 seconds. Let's do it.
I'm going to turn this phone off.
I'll call this meeting to order. We're going to have our invocation and pledge allegiance to the flag, and Commissioner Galey has the honor of doing that tonight.
If you care to pray, if you would join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we lift up our hearts to you with praise and thanksgiving for the Christmas season, for the promises that it brings, Lord. We pray for so many people in our community who will have an empty chair at their table, an empty place in their hearts this Christmas. Death has come to our community and taken those who we love, people who are dear to us. And there are many people in our community who are suffering. They're suffering because of the loss of a loved one. They're suffering because of the loss of income. They're suffering because of the loss of security and health. And Lord, we just pray where there is pain, where there is sorrow, where there is fear, that you would be there, that you would comfort those who are suffering, who are afraid, who are in hunger, who are in want, who are missing people that they love, that you would comfort them and be with them, and that they would feel your presence, Lord. Please help guide this board and other units of local government across this country, Lord, to make good decisions for the people that we serve. Make us worthy of the calling that you have placed before us, and help us to do your will and to do the will of the people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you would please stand and join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This time I have the honor of asking John Payne to come forward.
Thank you, Chair, Commissioners. I come before you tonight to recognize a couple of brave individuals that performed life-saving in a wreck back in June. I'd like to read this before we present them what we have for them. It takes just seconds for life to change. It also takes just seconds to save from death in a motor vehicle accident. Thanks to the quick reaction of Scott and Sean Solomon, two brothers, a life was saved on Alamance County Highway north of the city of Burlington. Ms. Susan Bishop was driving her vehicle on Saturday, June 30th, 2020, when she became the victim of a motor vehicle accident on Pagetown Road. Scott and Sean Solomon, who were traveling also on Pagetown Road, were the first to arrive at the scene of the accident. Unfortunately, the vehicle had caught fire and Ms. Bishop was unable to exit due to the extent of her injuries. Scott and Sean undoubtedly saved a life that afternoon for the emergency responders that arrived on the scene just a few seconds later. Ms. Bishop had already been removed from the burning vehicle by Scott and Sean and taken to a safe location for evaluation and transport by emergency services to a landing zone where she was flown out from the scene. Their quick response and immediate actions resulted in saving the life of Ms. Bishop. Alamance County would like to recognize the life-saving measure by presenting Scott and Sean Solomon with an award of valor from myself, John Payne, Alamance County Fire Marshal. Recognition is long past due. Ms. Bishop has undergone lengthy healing and recovery from her surgeries. Ms. Bishop requested that this presentation be made at a time when she would be able to attend and meet the brothers. With me tonight, I have Ed Lipscomb and Kyle Cook, two firemen from the chief and another fireman from AO Fire Department. We got Chief Apple from Wichita Fire Department back here. He came upon the scene right after the vehicle had the vehicle accident had occurred, and he alerted me to the accident that Scott and Sean had done. We have Scott and Sean, their guests back here, and also Miss Bishop and her husband was able to make it. They're right here also.
And we'll ask these parties, if possible, to come forward.
Okay. I do have some pictures of the vehicles. You got those? Just a couple pictures of the vehicles when they were still on scene out there, just to show exactly what had happened.
I don't have
the... Okay. I'll send them to him. Okay, that's fine.
You can go first on the
present to Scott Salomon, and it, what I said is what I read a while ago. I want to thank y'all for being in on the scene and doing heroic action to save Miss Bishop from her accident. It's for Scott. And also this for Sean. To thank my appreciation, I also got a small gift card token, not out of county tax dollars, but out of my own pocket. Well, that's really awesome.
And gentlemen, ma'am, we're so pleased to have everyone here, and you especially, because you might not be here otherwise.
If they hadn't done what they were doing, and God had not protected me, I would not be here.
Amen.
You're welcome to stay or welcome to leave, whichever you prefer.
Have a great Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
Make your blessing. You are blessed.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
We'll
be.
Thank you all for coming to see us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
You can't say thank you.
Everything that happened.
Never forget that. Ever.
Mm-hmm. You got the pictures I emailed you.
I think the five of us had wondered why anyone would want to be a county commissioner. That tells you why. Okay, we have public speakers.
Mr. Chair, we do not have anybody signed up or appearing in person or who has called in requesting to speak on any agenda items.
All right. Then I assume, are there any county commissioners' responses to the non-speakers? Okay. We have the approval of the agenda. I just have one single comment about the agenda. We have part of the agenda is delegation, assigning a voting delegate for the NCACC Legislative Goals Conference. That also, I noted going through the packet, allows for the an alternate delegate, which we have not assigned. Mr. Manager, do we need to take that off the consent agenda to put a secondary person in there? That would only apply if I was unable to attend.
I think if you wanted to, as part of the consent agenda, go ahead and select someone at this time that could be willing to be an alternate delegate, I think that would be appropriate, and we'll amend the form.
All right. Yeah, my name is down as the delegate to go to this. It'll be on Zoom or video anyway, so nobody's going anywhere. But it allows us to have someone from Alamance County to attend that meeting. I would suggest as vice chair that Steve Carter be placed in that secondary position.
I agree totally.
Does the entire board agree?
I do.
I make a motion that we amend the consent agenda item 6C to include an alternate delegate, Vice Chair Steve Carter.
I second that motion.
All right, any discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passes unanimously. Okay, now we need a motion on the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Actually, I think, Chair, if you don't mind, I don't think we've approved the overall agenda yet.
That's true.
Do we have a motion to?
I make a motion that we approve the agenda as amended.
I'll second.
In discussion, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Passes unanimously. Now, do we have a motion to pass the entire agenda as that's well, that takes care of that matter.
I make consent a motion agenda. That we approve the consent agenda as
second.
Amended.
In discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, nay. And I vote yea, not nay, to make that clear. Okay, it passes unanimously. Well, I want to just mention, if you were appointed to a board or something on that consent agenda, you have now been approved. Okay, we need to discuss the minutes from the November 2nd, 2020 meeting.
Mr. Chair, I believe that was part of the consent agenda.
Thank you. Okay, next is Jeremy Teeter.
Bring those folks right in.
All right.
Already coming in.
Amy, thank you.
Okay. Good evening, Chair Paisley, Commissioners, Mr. Haygood. It's a pleasure to be here again to make this presentation, and I know we've got new commissioners this round, and so I promise to answer any questions you may have as we address these slides. So as you know, I'm Jeremy Teeter, and I'm the finance officer for the school system. And so we're just going to touch on the money that we received last fiscal year and how we ultimately utilized that money. And we'll hit on a couple of other related points. The first slide is a pie chart that just denotes where our funding came from last year. The capital outlay looks a lot larger than normal, and that is because we put the full value of the $150 million bonds on our books. And so we manage those projects on a declining balance. So for example, the fiscal year we're in now, that figure is a few million less to reflect that we've spent some money towards those projects already. But typically, the state share of that pie chart is the largest share. And then you can see local funding is usually our second largest funding source, and we're very fortunate in Alamance County that we receive the local funding that we do. That local figure is a little over $47 million, and it's important to note that that's a collection of several things. The largest of that is the appropriation that we receive from the county, but in that local fund, it's also where we manage the fines and forfeitures that pass to us through the court system, and those were a little bit down last year due to closures in the court system. That's where we record any interest that we have earned on our cash. We do get a sales tax refund each year like county government does. The difference for us is that the local share only is refundable to school systems, whereas in your space, it's state and local. And then anytime that we engage in a lease for equipment, we're required to reflect that as money up front. And so that figure was about $2.9 million higher last year because we engaged in a lease for equipment, and that had to be reflected up front. The Child Nutrition Fund and the Daycare Fund that you see are our two enterprise funds, and so those operate independent of our taxpayer dollars, and both of those are profitable programs, and so they're not dependent on us to support them in any way. In more school systems than not, their child nutrition programs or their school food service are dependent upon local resources to balance out the books, but we're very fortunate that our program does not have to come to us to ask for money to help them make ends meet. They're totally able to do that on their own. The restricted grants category is where we manage any funds that we receive that are outside. They're generally speaking not taxpayer dollars, but they're grants that we've gotten from nonprofit, or they are fees that we have collected through services that we provide. An example of that would be we provide services to some students that are reimbursable under Medicaid, and we prepare an annual Medicaid filing each year to get to collect fees for that, and then we reinvest that money into those children and meeting the needs of those children. So those are just some examples of things that we manage there that are noteworthy. The next slide is always a very interesting topic with school boards and county commissions, and that is fund balance. And so this chart just quite literally shows the history of our fund balance from the point of merger and up. There's been quite a bit of change in the board since we were at that high point. And so that was in 2011 that the school board reached that $21 million mark. And that was a point of a lot of conversation between the two boards. And so the school system was strongly encouraged to engage in a spend down plan to bring that down to a more reasonable point. And so as you can see, the school system did that over a number of 3 to 4 years. That has slowly built back up. At this point, it's at about 6.2 million, if I'm rounding to the closest 100,000. And on the next slide, I'll touch on some of the reasons why we maintain fund balance. So the first reason is the timing of state budget versus local budget. So in a variety of seasons, the county government is much more efficient in producing a budget than we see at the state government. You all work as a team and you make it happen, and sometimes we just have gridlock in Raleigh, and it's after the school year has started before we know exactly what we're going to be dealing with in terms of state funding. So in the next month or so, we will begin our budget development process on the local end of things. And so around March the 1st, we'll share with Mr. Haygood what our needs are going to be. And the state will still be deliberating on things that have implications for that. So, for example, if we were not expecting teachers to get a raise and we planned accordingly, and then come August, we see a state budget that says, surprise, you know, we're going to give teachers a 5% raise this year. We've got to be prepared to deal with that and not come back to you and say, hey, please, can I have some more? And so we try to put ourselves in a position that we can respond to those situations. Federal funding is another area. So that runs on a different fiscal year, as you well know. They start in October. We don't always see that money in October, so a lot of times we're very dependent upon our local resources to help us kind of float some expenses as we're waiting to get money that we're due. And then our cash flow is another factor for us. And so a lot of our expenses are top heavy, and they're occurring in those first few months of the year. So it's usually about this time of the year that our revenue and our expenditures really start to even out on the local side of the coin. And so I actually looked at that before I left the office today, and we have kind of hit our break-even point finally. So having that fund balance in hand is critical to us to manage our cash flow as we incur expenses. The other category is, and this is one of the largest drivers behind why we're letting that accumulate a little bit, is we've got some large technology expenses coming up. We're at a point where next school year we'll be replacing 2,000 laptops for our teachers, and then we're replacing 9,000 student devices that are coming or that are aging out. And we're trying to move to a point to where we're not dependent on financing those things, to where we're building up a reserve and we can save on interest and just pay for those things as the need arises. So next year we're looking at quite a bit of technology expense that we're preparing for.
Jeremy, do you think with all the technologies had to go in home, and what's that going to look like as far, I don't think anybody understands the wear and tear and what we're going, and things aging out and everything else with being in a home.
It is, you know, so we have at this point, in terms of repairs, we've spent a little over $50,000 on repair parts this year.
Right.
You know, and every time I step down to the warehouse to check in on how the technicians are doing, they've just got tubs full of devices that have been turned into the schools that have had just wear and tear that has happened. So it's, you know, and some of those are newer machines, some are older, and you really cringe when it's a new machine that you were involved, you know, that you're involved in helping to get. But our really strong technology team, and I know that you know them well, and they're going right through that. Thank you for asking that question.
That's a big endeavor.
Yes, sir.
Do you have a phased plan for phasing the various equipment components out?
There is. So the teacher devices generally last us anywhere from 4 to 5 years. And then the student devices are split up into two waves. And so we had 8,000 or so that we replaced at the beginning of this current fiscal year. And then we've got another 9 that we'll replace next year. So they're kind of broken out in chunks, and the amount of time that we can expect those to last has gotten a little bit longer, and so we're at a point now where we can get about 6 years out of the latest Chromebooks for students, and a lot of that has to do with Google's willingness to keep the license active, and so if it weren't for that, we could probably get more out of them. But fortunately, they're phased in, and we're not having to deal with everything at one time.
So that's planned out, obviously.
Yes, sir.
So my computer that died over, the laptop that died over the weekend after barely 4 years, is premature. Is that correct?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay.
So, let's see. And we do run into that, right, where we will have issues with a few, and we keep some in reserve. But we have a few that get replaced ahead of schedule, kind of like what happened to yours. So, and I know your wife, so I know she was on top of that.
She taught you, did she not? Was she one of your teachers?
Yes.
That's what I thought.
Yes, she was my technology teacher. So in the next slide, so we've got a few slides that look like this just to show you for each fund kind of where those dollars are spent. And soon to be Senator Gailey will hear a lot about this in the coming months. And so with the state funds, these are appropriated to us in about 40 different buckets that we have to manage. And North Carolina is maybe one of 7 states that manages public school funding this way. Some states, they just refer to it as a block grant, and congratulations, you have $150 million and splice this out however you need to. But it comes to me in about 40 different pots, and they each have their own rules. And there's a very thick allotment policy manual that accompanies that and that we stick to. So, you know, a really good example of that is we get about $800,000 a year that is intended for central office administrators. And so we can only spend it on central office administrators. And so you'll hear a lot of talk about, well, you know, if you've got spending on central office, well, some of it we have to spend that way. And that is a category that we have seen at the state level that has gone down a little bit incidentally, but at any rate, you know, we get about these 40 different buckets. And another area I think in the community that I hear a lot of conversation about is with SRO funding, for example. One of our pots of money that is intended for at-risk schools, it allots money to us to have one school resource officer per high school, right? So as there are conversations in the community about defunding police, or we don't want SROs in our school, well, even so, right, you know, we have money that is very specifically intended for that purpose, you know, that we have to spend that way. And you know, and we have no plans, of course, of moving away from SROs, but that's just something that we've tried to educate in the community about, and that we have money for very specific purposes. And as you can see, the lion's share of the state fund is spent for salary and benefits for employees, with teachers certainly being the largest population of that. In the local fund, again, and you'll see this theme throughout, salary and benefits is the largest share. Contracted services, I've got a separate slide for services that I'll go into a little more detail on to give you a sense for what those services are that we use our local dollars for. Transfers is one that I really wanted to touch on with you. It's very pertinent to Alamance County right now, and that is representative of what we share with charter schools. And so in North Carolina, the public school system is the middleman between the local funding source and the charter schools. And so in 2016, we passed along $1,940,000 to charter schools. And as you can see, last year, that's a little over $2.7 million. So there's quite a bit of growth there. And I was curious to see, is that how has enrollment trended? How many charter school students have we been passing money along for versus how many we've had in ABSS? And so from 2016 to 2020, in terms of those fiscal years, our enrollment grew by 73 students, so it held fairly steady, and charter school growth was 279. And so what we're seeing is that as we continue to grow as a county, charter schools are absorbing some of what would otherwise be creating some challenges for us in facilities and fill in the blank other needs.
And charter schools are public schools.
They are public.
People think they're private, but they're not.
Correct. Yes, ma'am. And so from time to time, when we present our funding request to you, you will see a line in our budget request where we're noting increased charter school. And so we're trying to be mindful of that per pupil funding, and because we pass it along to them on a per pupil basis. And so if our enrollment's holding steady and theirs is growing, we're trying to keep some kind of balance there to where we're not taking a loss for our students to meet our obligations to them. And so that's always a tricky conversation to have, and I wanted to go ahead and put that out in front of you as a new board.
May I ask a question? I was wondering about, is there a date certain by which time, like if somebody decided to pull their child out of ABSS and put them in a charter school,
mm-hmm.
is it the end of the first 9 weeks? Is the date certain that the money doesn't move with that student now? And if they come back, it doesn't come back with the student?
So it's kind of twofold. The state money, there's a deadline that's set in stone. And so it's in October, we're required, the charter schools and the school systems, we're required to prepare a report that reflects our full rosters. DPI, or the Department of Public Instruction, makes an adjustment at that point. And so they try to estimate how many they think we're going to have based on prior years. And let's say if we had 40 more students go to a charter schools than the state thought we were going to, they'll adjust our funding to reflect, okay, they have 40 less students and they're going over here. And once they make that adjustment in October, that's all that happens with state funding. For the local that we're required to pass along, that's sort of real time on a month by month basis.
Okay.
And we do see that go up and down, and sometimes we'll see the same students kind of go back and forth, and reasons why I don't know. And we scrutinize those very carefully too, to make sure that they're in the boundaries of Alamance County, because we've just now with the growth that we've seen in Mebane and in Elon, we've got some communities that are crossing multiple counties. And but to answer your question, the state's got a hard cutoff for that money following, and then local can fluctuate.
Interesting. Mr. Teeter, do you see very many after the cutoff in October coming back to the public schools?
I think we, I wouldn't say it's a huge wave, but we will see a few from time to time.
What would you guesstimate a wave being?
I would say maybe we see anywhere from 5 to 10 potentially that
so
would come back.
So it's not a large number?
No, sir.
All right.
Yeah, it wouldn't be enough to make or break us in terms of how we operate.
So you don't think the legislature needs to inquire into that matter?
I don't think so. Yeah, all right. We're good. We'll let Ms. Gailey know for sure if something changes.
That's the purpose of the questions.
Yeah. So let's see. Okay. On the next slide, just sort of as promised, we break out the types of services. So the professional services category, that includes our contract for custodial services. And so for existing commissioners or folks who have been here before, as you know, we contract out our services for custodial, and that saves us about $1.5 million a year, because we're not having to pay into the state retirement system for those custodians, and we're not having to pay into the state health plan for those employees, and their benefits are pegged to whatever is available in the private sector with the BUD group who we contract with. That is the largest share of that. That's over $3 million of that figure in that top bar. About another million of that is for school resource officers that we're funding with local funds. That counts as a contracted service, because we're providing SROs far above and beyond what we get state funding for. So as I mentioned before, we get state funding, but they've got a cap for how much they provide, and the sheriff and I have had lots of great conversations about that. And so the school system had been paying the law enforcement agencies up to what the state was giving us, and what we found is that's an outdated number, and it's far more expensive to provide an SRO than that rate. And so we've done a lot of work. Yes, sir.
How many schools do we have now that don't have an SRO?
Let's see, I do some quick math. So every high school has one, every middle school has one. We have 6 elementary schools that have a permanent one half days. And so that leaves you with 14 schools that are not yet.
But 6 only have a half a day?
Yeah.
Now, is that split between?
That's right. So
one SRO for 2 schools?
Yes. Yeah, so those 6 schools are in the sheriff's jurisdiction. So it's Altamaha Ossipee and Pleasant Grove who share one. B. Everett Jordan and Sylvan share one. And then Alexander Wilson and E.M. Holt share one. And so it will be sort of a short-term goal for us to shore that up, so that each of those have their own. When we started pushing for more elementary SROs, we started with those most rural schools, just because of their distance away. And so so we started out with the 4, and then the year we're in now is when we added Alexander Wilson and E.M. Holt. But it's a very short-term goal for those 6 schools to have their own, which would mean adding 3. Wink, wink, you may see something about that in the next budget request. But fortunately, the state does offer an elementary SRO grant that we apply for every year. They have not turned us down so far. They will provide $33,333 per SRO, and then we make up the difference,
right,
with local money to fund the full SRO. And so it'll be our intent each year to apply for more until we can make sure every school has one.
I know, I really have said before, I really would like to see us have an SRO in every school.
Yeah. Well, SRO, Sylvan's not full-time, right?
It's half-time, right.
So probably your crisis will not happen while your SRO
right
is there.
Yeah.
So that's, yep. Yeah, think about that logistics.
Modify that to full-time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's a very...
That's Navy SEALs. That's, yeah, what I'm talking about.
So that's, yeah, very much, right? It's very much in our... within the next year, our goal is for those to have full-time. And then we'll start working in more into city limits after that. So, yeah, but about a million local.
As you know, at least two of us, and Bill, you may have as well, I don't know whether you did or did not, campaigned on an SRO in every school full time.
That's good.
What's the justification for that request?
So I think it's twofold, particularly at the elementary level. I think we have found that the relationships that are formed at that level mm-hmm. mitigate issues up the pipeline at the middle and the high school. And then I think, this is talking to SROs directly. I think they have found that kids come forward to them with issues that they may not come forward to with anyone else, but they feel like this SRO is the person I need to tell. And that leads to some things that are addressed in the home life of our students. And then I think three, and probably the most obvious, is just the threat that our schools are under all the time. And we know that they're a target for folks who mean to do harm. And we know having an armed officer is a deterrent for folks who are looking to do harm. So three very major reasons.
Well, before you sit down, I'm going to recognize Dr. Benson. And I'm not telling you to sit down yet, but I'm just warning him. I'm going to ask him the same question when he comes forward.
Okay. Yeah.
It was, we're trying to prepare everyone in Alamance County to know why these SROs are so needed.
Yeah, absolutely. The second largest category in our chart, the property services, that is predominantly utilities, and that is a space where we have concentrated effort in the past couple of years to reduce those expenditures, particularly in the space of electricity. Mm-hmm. And so the county commissioners, in tandem with the school board, authorized a performance contracting effort where we replaced the lighting in every building with energy efficient lighting, and that required a loan to do that. But with the understanding that our utility savings would be in line with the cost of that loan each year or better. And if not, then the contractor would eat the difference. And so last year was a little weird because we did not have little people in the building for a few months. And so that was to be the first full year of performance contracting in place. So we did save money on utilities. And we saved enough on utilities, but it's hard to say how much of that, what share of that is from the performance contracting and what share of that is from having less people in buildings and so forth. But we'll have a normal year here soon, and we'll establish a good baseline for that utility usage. But the good news is utilities were cheaper last year than they were the year before, so we're happy about that. And so to that point, the debt service that's on that chart for 5/24/04 was the value of our payments for that particular debt last school year. Okay, so those are the noteworthy things there. The federal category, just like others, fairly heavy on salary and benefits. The two largest federal programs that we participate in is, one is our Title I programming, and that's a federal program that's designed to provide supplemental resources for our schools that have a high free or reduced lunch or a high poverty compared to other schools. And so those schools then take those resources and line that up with things that they think are going to be helpful. Usually it is additional staff. They will hire additional teachers to reduce the class sizes in those schools, or they may feel it's necessary to have an additional counselor, fill in the blank. And so that's why you see that. The other large program in the federal umbrella is to support our students with special learning needs. And that's under the umbrella of the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And so that is the federal government's effort to provide additional resources to support students that have greater than normal needs that need to be met. And that typically results in additional teachers to meet those needs.
Is that like Turning Point, adaptive curriculum?
Exactly. Okay. The next category just shows where our capital outlay revenue came from last year. So as the county is hopefully familiar by now, we've got the capital improvement plan that was a joint effort between the two boards and the community college. And with that plan that was pulled together, the school system received $3.3 million to meet our just our regular capital needs and our facilities. And that is connected very much so to our 7-year capital improvement plan, where we've got very specific things that are scheduled out, some of which is safety related, since we've been talking about that this evening. The other large category for our revenue last year were bond proceeds. So we spent a little bit over $4 million on the bond projects last year, the biggest share of that being the land for the new high school, and then the remainder for design work and survey work. We had a little bit spent on lottery from lottery for various projects that were outstanding under that funding source, and some capital reserves, which is the money that stems directly from sales tax. And then before I retire, this other pot's going to be gone. And so this is the 2004 bond interest. And so in 2004, when the county sold about $36 million in bonds, Susan Evans explained to me that that money was held in savings and it generated some interest. And so that's been steadily spent down over time. It's probably about $50,000 left from that old bond interest, and it has to be spent on the projects that were originally connected to that bond in 2004.
Jeremy, can I ask you to do me a favor?
Sure.
I know there's such a big misconception about the lottery.
Uh-huh.
Everybody thinks you buy a ticket and 99 cents of that dollar goes to that. I know there's a cap, there's so many counties, public, all kind of stuff. Could you help the public and anybody else understand that all of the lottery money is not divided among school systems?
Right. Well, and there are other programs that I think don't get a lot of attention that are part of that benefit from the lottery. So pre-K programs in North Carolina benefit from the lottery. And so and because of that, we do administer a pre-K program in Alamance Burlington schools. But that money flows from the lottery funding source down to the Alamance Partnership for Children in our case, and then they parse that out to pre-K programs throughout the county. And so we see about $1.2 million a year from that program to support pre-K in our schools. That money also goes to scholarships for students, in not only in public but private. You know, you have access to those lottery scholarships. But then, you know, it does also go to construction, and you know, we see anywhere from 1.4 to 1.6 million a year here in Alamance County once it's all said and done. So it's definitely not a solution to all of our problems. So I'm glad that you asked that.
But I'm thankful.
Oh, absolutely.
It's amazing, but
yeah,
still.
It is an integral plan. It is an integral part of our capital improvement plan between us and the county, for sure. The next category, you know, this is one of our enterprise funds that I mentioned earlier. It is the only category where you'll see that supplies are almost equal to what we spend on people, and that's because of we're buying food and processing supplies to make the school food service operation happen. But again, fortunately, they are totally self-sufficient. Okay, and our daycare fund, which has not operated in a few months, and we look forward to that getting back on track with the start of school. Again, that category, it's salary and benefits. We have 14 schools that operate a daycare program, and that's just a before and after school program where parents can pay a fee to drop their student off at 7 in the morning or have them stay after school until 6 o'clock. And 13 of those are elementary schools, and we do have one middle school that participates, and that's Hallfields Middle.
Does that fee offset the cost, or is that
absolutely
supplement?
Absolutely. So in a normal year, last year was atypical because we wrapped things up in March, but in a normal year that program posts about a $200,000 profit. And so the school, the individual schools that operate, get to keep those proceeds and put that back into the school in some way. I've been an advocate for every elementary school to do one. Mm-hmm. Can't quite get them all there, but eventually we will get them there, because there's a lot of value for our parents and for the school.
And I know in transfer appeals, that's a big deal for a parent having to look at another school because of their work schedule out of county, whatever. Because, I mean, that's life, and it makes a big difference.
Yeah, and it's very affordable, the rate that we charge. So this was the other category that we talked about. This is the restricted grant fund. This is one I want to make sure Senator Gailey protects. So this is what at the state level is called Fund 8 quite frequently, and that's...
Fund 8,
yep. And that is the category where if we... any funds that we keep here, we're not required to share it with the charters. So the general statute says we're required to share our county appropriation, and we're required to share fines and forfeitures with charter schools. But if we were to manage any of these grants in the local fund, we would technically have to share those too. So Fund 8 was created to provide a means for school systems to protect other grants that we receive. And so just sort of the general feeling is, right, if we've applied for a grant from Impact Alamance, well, we applied for it, and so we don't want to have to share it with someone who didn't apply for it. And so this helps us to protect that money and keep us from having to share. And I don't want us to sound greedy, but that's charter school can apply for a grant too. And you will see that we do here cover a lot of salary and benefits, and that is our pre-K program that's managed there. And then that is when we're reinvesting those Medicaid claim dollars, we're in turn hiring people to work with those students. So we really do try to put that back into the program. Okay. This is a chart that I like to prepare every year, and it just shares what our top 10 vendors are, where we're spending our money. And as you can see, our custodial contract group is at the top. Duke Energy's number 2. What's interesting to us is we have 2 charter schools that make that top 10 list for folks that we're sharing money with, and that just sort of illustrates the magnitude. One area that we're proud of is so that the Xerox line there, that $720 for copier usage, that's $220,000 cheaper than it was the year before. That had not been competitively bid in a number of years. We put it out for bid and saved a lot of money in a hurry, and so we're very proud of that. And the other thing I think we're proud of is we're seeing more things make this top 10 list that have an impact on student learning, and it doesn't look like just all overhead operational type things. So we're seeing more things make this list that have to do directly with student learning. The last 2 slides, we just wanted to hit on some things that we're proud of and things that came about because of your support and your investment in Alamance Burlington Schools. And so we spend a large sum of money every year on teacher supplements to be competitive with teacher pay. And for 3 years in a row now, you know, we have ranked number 10 in the state of North Carolina where teacher pay is concerned. And so we're very proud of that, and we shout that from the rooftop when we're recruiting. But then we also have the unique challenge of being surrounded by number 2, number 3, number 5, and number 6, and number 7. And so we're having to stay on our toes. But I think we're finding that we're competitive enough, that we can get good folks here. And we could not do that without the support that we get from the county commissioners. The final slide is related to our workers' comp trend. And so the 2 years that are in yellow reflect the years that we hired a risk manager, and we've had a risk manager on staff to manage our transferring of risk and staying on top of preventing losses. The current year is kind of weird. If we were in a normal school year, that would probably be hanging around 20,000. So it would be about half of what the prior year is, but we haven't had the students in the building, and we've just been less opportunities for occupational hazard without the students in the buildings. But nonetheless, we're very, very proud of that progress that we've made there in trying to be good stewards of our resources. And I think a couple of years ago when Dr. Benson and I came on board, we found that this was an area where we were gushing money and we needed to do something to stop the bleeding. And we were fortunate that we found the right person for the risk manager job, and she has been on it. And so now we're really starting to reap the rewards where that's concerned in terms of what we're paying for insurance coverage for workers' comp. So
what is that salary for that position?
It's at considering the savings is fairly low, it's about $56,000.
Wow.
Yeah.
And looking at the numbers,
yeah,
that's impressive.
Yep. Yeah. So we're very fortunate. So that was everything that I have prepared, and I know Dr. Thorpe is up next, but if you have any other additional questions for me, I'm happy to answer those.
I know we're going to recognize Dr. Benson. We've had a request for a short recess.
Okay.
Dr. Benson, anything you want to add to this particular topic before we take a recess?
Just to reiterate, we appreciate the support of the commissioners. And we've worked hard the last 2 years to make sure that we're spending money in ways that have positive outcomes, both in terms of managing those resources, but also in terms of positive outcomes for students. So an example of that would be our high school graduation coaches. Previously, that program was not improving our on-time graduation rate. We revamped the program, and now we have the highest on-time average graduation rate that we've had in 5 years. So we're committed to continuing to do better, and I very much appreciate Mr. Teeter's support and diligence in managing our financial resources. So thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll also acknowledge that Mr. Teeter is a result of the Alamance Burlington school system.
That's right.
It merged while I was in the third grade. I always like to point that out because, you know, people make so much fuss about merger, but it wasn't noticed by the people who matter, and that was the students. I did not see a change in the quality of the education I got. So it was a good education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to take a 10-minute recess. Okay, we're back in order. At this point, I asked Dr. Benson if he wanted to introduce the next speaker, and he said no. So, Dr. Thorpe, do you want to come forward, please?
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Appreciate this opportunity to go over a few things with you. Start off with, every 5 years, DPI requires us to do a facility study. The facility study consists of deficits that we know of, or deficits that we project that will be happening over the next. It's a 10-year period that we do. We have to rate it for 0 to 5 and then 6 to 10. This particular study, because we just passed the bonds and we're into design services, it reflects the $150 million still because the work has not been completed. So, start off with, I'm going to remind you, Mr. Teeter did a great job talking a little bit about the 7-year plan. We do have a 7-year plan. Our board adopted it. It's been presented to this board. It is line itemed of things that, you know, some things that we're required to do yearly. Other things are repairs that we need to do. We focus strongly the first 4 years on the plan into safety. As you know, many of our schools were built years before this was a critical need. So we dedicated the first 4 years to just safety alone. Spending about half the budget in that line item. You'll see 1.1 pretty much across the board. That was taking a cluster of schools. This year we've worked on the Williams Zone. Next year we're moving into the Graham and Cummins area, and we'll just go out over the next 4 years. The safety piece of that includes putting vestibules in, cameras in, and badge in access to your doors. Then you will see in numerous other needs, roofing's being one of our major needs still, although we've done a lot of work in that area. There's the 4 to 7. Your facility needs. Our board approved this in a November meeting. The commissioners do not have to approve it. You'll have to sign off saying that you've been given a copy, and Brian has the notebook full of all the background work that goes into it. These numbers are generated through either current cost of what we know or cost that the state gives us. An example would be when you see windows. A lot of times they give you a dollar figure per square foot. You put in the square footage of the building, and it gives you the number that goes with it. On the 0 to 5, you're talking $257 million. But again, remind you the $150 million bond is in that number, so that reduces that number. Also, another thing in the whole program, you're seeing where you see additions. It's either where we have schools crowded to where we're going to have to set mobile units in the very near future, or to replace the mobile units we currently have. We did attempt to move two of our older units this year, and it was, we made it, but by the time you move one of the older units and you put the money back into it to fix it back up after the move, it's not financially worth it. It is still cheaper than purchasing a new one, but it still takes a lot of work and money to get them back up. If you'll see on the 6 to 10, we estimate about another $108 million. So the whole thing alone is $350 million, a little better than $350 million of needs across our school district. While I'm up here, I'm going to touch briefly on the bonds and touch briefly on the capital monies that we do spend. That way you see where your investment's at. I think it's important that not only you, but our community also knows where our financial investments are going for our schools. South Mevin Elementary School, if you remember, it went to bid, came in at a great number. It's well underway. If the weather would cooperate, we would finish up all the grading. We hit about the 95%. And once we hit that, the rain came in. Give me another 2 weeks of dry weather. We'll be ready to start the building. But we have used this time for some of the renovations of the cafeteria to put a roof on a part of a building. So we are moving along. If you've not had a chance to go to that site, feel free. If you let me know, I'll meet you out there. Jimmy Russell will meet you out there, and we'll walk you through what's going on. New high school. This is on the website that the county posts on. We keep it on there, and some of you had the privilege of seeing most of these slides the other day, but I thought it was important to share them with everyone. So we are in the bid of our bond, or in the bid document process of our bonds. The Alamance Burlington High School at this point. These are, and as you can see, it's a very nice facility. It's a good use of space. Should serve the county well for 50 years, 60 years. Let's say we get 80 years out of a building. So Southern High School, just a quick overview. You've seen this drawn many a times, but Southern, Eastern, and Western all are getting a building. Southern and Eastern is getting a new front entrance that designates the front entrance of a building. The old concrete canopy is going away, bathroom renovations, asphalt will be down. They're getting a cafeteria expansion as well as an outdoor eating area. Kids enjoy eating outdoors, so let's give them a nice area to eat in. Graham, there again, same thing. Some architects like to be really bright. Big thing about Graham is it's the vocational side, since it was designated as a trade school. But it will be beneficial no matter how we use it. Cummins High School, fine arts. So a lot of attention being given into your music hall, as they call it, auditorium upgrades. Mm-hmm. If you've been in that auditorium, you notice that the lobby is not a lobby. It's just a corridor. Mm-hmm. So we are going to increase that area, as well as all the projects will include a safety vestibule going into their buildings. So we're going to correct that with the bond, as well as do the badge in access and camera, new camera systems. So the bond's covering that, so that won't be coming out of capital money for our high schools. There's your lobby addition. Gives you a better cluster for restrooms.
I like restrooms.
You do, yeah. Especially that pink shelf.
That pink shelf, yeah. Took 8 years.
But it's gone. Our new seating will be accommodating ADA requirements. As we, you know, these schools were built before they were a requirement. We've had to make some accommodations to win audit, but we will be making more.
What's the capacity in there, do you know?
It's going to be similar to what it is now, which is 630. We're still working on the final counts of the seats. We actually think we're going to be able to add a few seats because it takes away when we do the handicap seating area, right? Because you have to do the buddy. So we're looking to see if we can come down maybe one more row on the floor, so we can keep the capacity. Eastern High School, if you notice, they're getting, like I said, a new building, but theirs is down around their circle, which really designates the front of the school. Right now, if you walk on Eastern or Southern's campus, if you don't know where the front of the school's at, you will wander all the way around the school trying to figure out where the front's at. So this will give a clear definition for folks when they enter where they should be entering. That does help, you know, surprisingly enough, that helps your SRO and your other folks on duty, because you're not having to look for those people roaming as much. And if you do see one roaming, there's a reason they're roaming, because they definitely knew where to go.
Tell them about those little squiggly snakes that are walls.
Those are walls. Those are, all of our schools were built with the Florida-style campuses, which means you can park anywhere and walk on the campus without any restrictions. So as an alternate bid, we're putting in a wall, kind of like what you see in a housing development, not like a prison wall, but more so of a, you know, pleasing type wall, curves, some landscaping. Yeah, I've had folks say, well, you can jump over the wall. Yes, you can. You can jump over anything we put in there. But to put a wall to start create barriers for folks to say, no, this is not where you come in at, you or to go to a certain area to come in.
What's the height on that wall?
Between 6 and 8 feet. We're working on it both ways. It's probably going to be more around the 5.5 to 6 foot range.
So cameras be able to see the wall during the day too? Mm-hmm. Or?
Yes, the cameras will be located where you can see kind of a cross reference. This is Eastern. Eastern and Southern, the front of the school, as you can see on the bottom drawing, that's more important right now for you to see. Definitely clear, that's the front of the school. It gives the higher roof. You know, people ask, why do you put the higher roof? Well, you got to put something to catch people's eye that, hey, this is where I enter. Western High School. Western High School already has a pretty well-defined front. We're going to do a little bit there to create a safety vestibule and some things different. So their building is going to go towards their bus lot. That secures the building off that side road there, which will also be a lot quicker and closer for kids getting off the bus to get into the dry.
Right.
A lot less awning you have to lay out there for them. Williams High School. Williams, the primary amount of the bond is being spent in the auditorium, upgrades in the auditorium. Yeah, it's a beautiful facility, 2,200 plus people. The Grand Oregon, very nice facility, but it's not been upgraded in years. So we're looking at seating upgrades, we're looking at new carpet, paint, new boiler. Sound system. New chiller plant.
Chiller.
That will get a new chiller plant.
The boiler out too.
The boiler on that plant's actually one of the newer boilers.
Oh, really? Okay.
On that particular side, so it will get a new chiller plant. We will look at the boiler. If it could be better served in another part of the building and go ahead and replace it, we may do that.
Okay.
Some bathroom upgrades, some additional restrooms. If you've been in Williams and ever tried to go to the restroom there at any type of intermission, it's a 2 to 3 person max. So we're going to bring those up to code, as well as we're going to work on bringing up the code with the bathrooms inside the building. Security upgrade, a safety vestibule, the whole 9 yards there. Pleasant Grove. Pleasant Grove is an engineering nightmare or feat, whichever way you want to call it. It is an older school, but we got a great plan to bring it back up to date and make it look more like a newer school. I mean, you won't change certain aspects of it, but when we look at the electrical services, getting a standardized electrical service throughout the building, get rid of the HVAC system that's currently in there because it's it's outdated, put in some drop ceilings to hide, you know, hide some of the ugly as far as the conduit, the piping, those type things. That goes a long ways for students when they walk in. We did not include this project on the LED lighting project we did because we knew the upgrades that we have to do, so we will do a lighting upgrade, and there'll also be a new fire alarm installed. I failed to mention all our projects, the fire alarm system is either being upgraded or replaced.
Now, that's a building that you have to go up the stairs to get to the gym and so forth.
That's Grove Park.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Grove Park and Eastlawn. You got steps going to both of those.
Is that being corrected?
As far as those goes, we got elevators that can.
You do have?
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent.
I like the fuse panel boxes.
Oh, yes.
Second, right.
Second to the right, bottom.
Maybe
yes.
The county can mop that.
We probably can use it in one of our museums around here. Yeah.
That's a hot mess.
Just talking about it, one reason it's important when you go back to our 7-year plan, you look at our electrical upgrades. We got several schools that still have the original breakers that were put in the schools years ago, which you cannot buy over the shelf now. So we have to buy remanufactured ones if one goes bad. Now, they very seldom go bad, but when they do, we do have to do remanufactured. So part of the electrical upgrades that you'll see in our seven-year plan is to start pulling some of those boxes and replace them with more modern-day boxes. Roofing projects, ESOM, Grant Middle School, that's one of the last ones that was left in the settlement that we did several years ago. Western High School, that one was not one of the settlement, but the areas over the fine arts area. It was a roof that had been patched several times and then went up on it, and it was like you was walking on a waterbed. When it failed completely. So it's all the way down through the insulation and everything. Seller's Gun, that's another one of the settlements. I was actually on it today. It's much closer to completion at this point. Yeah. And really, Seller's Gun has made a difference by putting a roof on a building. It makes a difference in any building you do. When you tighten the building up itself, it just makes a big difference. Graham High School, that's fine arts area, that gravel. You can see the rest of it has TPO on it. That section was never replaced. Woodlawn, the dark part of the roof, it can be one or two things. It can either be dirt or it can be where the roofing material is failing. Unfortunately, this is where the roofing material is failing. And it's been on there for 25 plus years, so we've got the expected life out of it plus a little more. Western High School, some of this will happen during the bond, but you can see the roof there. There's some need to go ahead and do a partial replacement before the bond can actually kick in, because our cafeteria in the kitchen, when it rains outside, it's raining inside as well. Safety vestibules, just to give you some idea of the ones we've done. This is Smith Elementary. It makes a big difference to create an area where people walk in the door. A little transaction window, and it is designed to where if you just need to drop lunch money off, a book bag off, whatever, you can just hand it through the window. You don't have to come in the building. It controls that traffic. Also, there typically will be a computer sitting out there, so if you're a volunteer, you just sign in there. They buzz you on into the school, keeps the traffic down out of the office. A lot of positives. The schools that have them are really excited about actually getting to use them soon, hopefully. And if you notice on the left-hand corner, this is something that me and Mr. Russell pushed for. We now have a camera in these schools that's mounted to where when they look out, they see the whole area. Where we were using the cameras that just look at the person, this gives them a better view of who is all with that person. So it does give them a much broader view. There's just some more pictures of Smith. Hillcrest, very similar. Basically the same building. If you've seen the footprint, they are the same footprint. To me, it's a really clean look. It doesn't look like we've done it doesn't look like we've done something invasive to the building, but it does look really clean. Highland, same way. And all those projects come in way under budget, which really was very pleasing. COVID has helped us in some ways, which that's kind of hard, strange to say, but we've had several projects come in under budget for folks that's had projects to get canceled because of COVID. So, you know, they're willing to bid to get work to keep their people working. Turntown Middle School, we are putting a front entrance there on the left. Right now, if you walk into school, you can pretty much travel everywhere. They do have a completely new camera system. If you look on that front hall, you see new ceiling tiles. That was one of the schools that was just open to the to the decking, and it looked really bad. Plus, just the years of wear and tear on the little 8x8 tiles, it was time to do something different. So we took the opportunity when we put the cameras in to go ahead and update that area as well. Grove Park, you mentioned Grove Park a while ago. When you go into Grove Park, you have to walk up steps to get to the office, which does not meet any ADA requirements. So now the front office is going to become that first classroom on the right. The office area, the principal's office will stay where it's at. But the receptionist area in that area will become a workroom, and the workroom's going to become a teacher's room. So we're just relocating space. But this way we can create a true front entrance to that school that, that parents can access without having to worry about ADA liabilities. Graham Middle School was able to get cameras in that school this summer. ADA compliance. This is from a federal audit. Anywhere you have CTE courses, you can undergo a 10-year audit. And the audit, you know, it's there to make sure their programs are accessible. So Graham High School, we had to put in some new counters, had to redo some things there because it still had the very old school where you walk up and the counter's right here. So we had to put lower cuts in. Williams High School, we've got lifts now everywhere you can possibly think of. They were never really paid any attention, but there was no lift going down to the locker room area. So we had to install a lift there. Southern High School, behind their stage, the dressing rooms, nor was the restrooms ADA compliant, so we upgraded that. High schools, most of our schools have the old turn knob locks. That does not meet ADA requirement. It takes a lever. So the classrooms where CTE classes were taught in, we had to do an immediate upgrade there. We'll be addressing other areas in the near future with bonds and additional funds. There's your high schools. Those are called buddy seats. So if someone's in a wheelchair, they can pull a wheelchair right beside there. Whoever travels with them can sit with them. There's your fax kitchens. I didn't think of what the new terminology was. We used to call it home ec. Family and consumer science now, so that's their kitchens. You have to have where you can get a wheelchair underneath a sink. And the stove to the right, that was important because all of our stoves had the knobs on the top side, but you do have to have them to where they're at a proper level. Additional parking. Listening devices. Our auditoriums do not have listening devices for folks that may be deaf or hard of hearing. So we made purchases there and made some changes in how that works in different schools. There again, your handicapped seating for your high schools, concrete work. Water fountains. We still had a lot of the old water fountains that came almost to the ground. So we had to do some upgrades in our water fountains. High schools, the piping underneath the sink has to be covered. That's, you know, for fear of someone in a wheelchair rolling up underneath one and catching their leg on a sharp piece of metal. And here's COVID. This year has been a major undertaking. Gym floors. Cummins High School, someone removed the doors, the fire doors or the smoke doors there years and years and years and years ago. It's been so long ago nobody knew they were gone. So we have built an excellent relationship not only with Alamance County but with Graham and with Burlington Fire Departments. We worked together to get that installed back like they wanted it and how it should have been left to begin with. Painting, as you know, we paint schools. This is Williams High School where all the plaster was falling off, all the peeling was going on. So it looks totally different now. And that's all I have for you. Again, I came for a couple things. I do have to present that DPI report, so I wanted you to see it. If you have time, you know, Brian will definitely share that with you. If you go through it and you got any questions, feel free to give me a call, stop by, whatever. But I also wanted you to see that, you know, the capital monies, and we are trying to address the issues and how important it is for us to be able to maintain that 7-year plan. We do have some bigger projects that may come up over time. I've always felt like I've worked really well with this board to find the funding when the projects have come up and has been outside of our scope, and hopefully we'll continue that same progress.
Thank you.
Questions?
Dr. Benson, do you have anything you want to add? All right. And thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very informative.
That's a lot of work and a lot of doorknobs.
Absolutely.
And it costs a lot of money, but all those little things make everything look so good. And I went through a shooter drill at Pleasant Grove when I was teaching junior achievement, and it was in the second grade. It was the eeriest thing I've ever done. That school was like, it was so quiet, and when the principal would shake that old door, it just, but those kids knew exactly what to do. They went into position. It was just amazing. But I just know that Pleasant Grove needs a full-time SRO, because while we're in those classrooms going through that, nobody was there to stop what could have been coming in the front. So it's just so crucial. We've had to learn some really hard lessons from seeing other schools suffering losses on television, and I don't want us to be that school.
I might also add that when I was county commissioner in 2014, we allotted money for roofs and all kinds of things, and it didn't happen. Thank you for allowing the things that we fund to happen. We appreciate it.
It's a really good team.
Mr. Haygood, I think you're the next up.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening. Good evening, Board of Commissioners. I'm here this evening to follow kind of on the heels of some of what you've heard tonight from the school system, to talk a little bit about school system capital improvement funding for this fiscal year. So as Dr. Thorpe mentioned, we have a capital improvement plan for Alamance County government that includes capital projects and funding for the court system, county government itself, and then, of course, the school system. School system is one of our largest capital recipients. We're statutorily required to take care of their properties. So we've made a plan that took into account bond projects as well as non-bond projects. So I'm here tonight to talk to you about the capital improvement plan, CIP funding for the school system. So the county uses sales tax. We have restricted articles 40 and 42 that are sales tax dollars that are required by law only to be used for school system capital. So it's sales tax revenue that we receive, but the state has said, counties, you must spend this money on school system capital. We use our restricted sales tax revenues for ABSS CIP dollars, their annual $3.3 million that you heard Dr. Thorpe mention, as well as we pay some debt service with our sales tax dollars too. So in our capital plan that we have put together, we have laid out $3.3 million a year for the school system to have in CIP funds annually. You heard Dr. Thorpe mention and show you projects they've lined up for the next 7 years. So the county's existing CIP plan says school system is slated to get $3.3 million a year every year for 7 years. And the way we've done our capital budget now, it's pretty much totally separate from operations. It's funded by that step down tax increase that was put into place for the bonds, as well as these sales tax dollars. So the good thing from our perspective, and I think from the school system's perspective too, is if they're receiving regularly $3.3 million, it enables them to be able to plan out lists of projects. In the past, the dollar amounts for CIP annual funds from the county have been up and down, and it's made it a little difficult, I think, for the school system to lay out a plan over multiple years. I'm sure Dr. Thorpe would tell you these projects, as we know from county projects, they take a while. You have to receive bids. Sometimes they take architectural work. So it's beneficial if there is some consistency. And they also work pretty hard to make sure the projects are done in a way that minimizes student impact. Now, over COVID, obviously, it's not been quite as big a concern because there haven't been kids in the schools. But normally, the school system, if they know they're getting $3.3 million or some dollar amount, they're able to plan those projects to come in and work over those summertime months when the kids are gone and they can really knock it out. So it's been important for us to try to stick to this $3.3 million annual CIP for ABSS. But of course, this year with COVID, it had a significant impact to our projection for sales tax dollars. When we were doing the budget for this fiscal year 2021, we were in the heart of lockdown, very uncertain what was going to happen. The feedback and guidance we were getting from Association of County Commissioners and the League of Municipality, wide variance, anywhere from 12 to 50% estimate in what counties and cities should think about for sales tax reduction. So we lit on projecting 20% sales tax revenue decrease for this fiscal year. That was our budget, and that was what we the dollar figures that we budgeted for this fiscal year. So what did that mean to the school system? It meant instead of $3.3 million, we were projecting that there would only be $2,702,240 available for them to use. So because of the 20% decrease, they would have lost $597,760 from their annual CIP amount. But to be extra cautious, I only budgeted $1.2 million for them to go into their budget, because the way the law works, once we put money in their budget, they will receive those funds, even if sales tax would have gone worse than 20%. At the time, we didn't know what was going to happen, so we budgeted $1.2 million in their CIP instead of 3.3, and we put $1,502,240 into our budget, not into their budget, but into a capital reserve, to wait and see what's going to happen throughout the fiscal year. Could this come back? So thus far, the school system has received $600,000 from county government for their CIP plan for this fiscal year. We pay them $100,000 a month, and we pay them six installments. So we've paid them $600,000. But bottom line, instead of $3.3 million, they've had access to $1.2 million. They've received $600,000 of it at this point, all based on the fact that we were projecting COVID to have a traumatic impact on sales tax. So this is a good opportunity for me to kind of let the board know what we're seeing as far as sales tax revenue. So this far in fiscal year 2021, just to give you an idea of how things are going, September of 20, this past September, and we have a several month delay in when we receive our sales tax because the state collects it, sends it back to the counties. So in September of 20 versus last September of 19 is actually a 20% increase. So instead of being 20% down from 2019, we are 20% higher in 1 month, just in the month of September. For the fiscal year, July through September of 20 versus July through September of 19, we're at almost 10% increase. So instead of a 20% decrease, we've actually seen almost 9.6% increase revenue. Much, much higher revenue than we would have ever imagined coming in from sales tax. And I think the final piece to look at that will help the commissioners understand how sales tax is performing for March through September of 2020, which is the COVID months, right? That's the when COVID really took off in March till September of this year versus March through September of 2019, we've seen over 5% increase in revenue. So there were some bad months, March, April, May. But overall, sales tax revenue is coming in extremely strong this fiscal year. We've already collected a little over $3 million in this restricted sales tax revenue that is destined for the school system. That's only in four payments. Now, that top data under that first bullet, that's in the finance report that's in your packet. We've received October's since this has gone out. We've looked at October's. So for October, with all the rest of the months, July, August, September, and October, we've received over $3 million in revenue specifically for the school system, four payments. Our goal for the fiscal year to make $3.3 million work and pay the debt service that we use sales tax dollars for is a little over $6.2 million. So we feel certain that in the next eight payments, we're going to hit that target. In fact, running the numbers, the sales tax would have to decrease by 40% from last fiscal year for us to not be able to meet a $3.3 million CIP plan and the school system debt service that we pay with sales tax, and we'd still be able to fund the capital plan. I mean, sales tax is coming in that strong. So it's very surprising. Yes, sir.
I was going to say, if Saturday was any indication, you couldn't even find a parking place in Tanger.
Well, I'm sure. I think between
not get a parking place.
Folks are spending money locally. I think they are, from what we hear, the online shopping that folks are doing, where the sales tax is being accounted to the county or the city where they live, as opposed to going to Friendly or Streets of South Point and Durham or Wake or Guilford County getting those dollars, is making a huge difference. Something that we could have never predicted before COVID.
Brad, do you think that maybe the vaccine is really giving a lot of hope to people that they're going to get their life back? As far as, I mean, it's just been so hard. And I mean, we're all sitting here in masks and school's out and everything like that. But I would have to think that that's a real hope. You know,
I
we're going to get back
agree.
To whatever normal is, whatever normal is going to be. This is great.
I think so. I think folks are obviously from a sales tax perspective. Again, global pandemic, possibly not since 1918, I guess. It's very hard to know what to predict. Mm-hmm. Back in April, May, when we were preparing this year's budget, I would have never guessed this. felt like we were being very conservative, which we were, but what we're seeing is sales tax revenues coming in tremendously above what we had planned. And I think this graph really kind of helps, will help the board understand what's going on here. So the green line going up and down, that's fiscal year 18-19's actual sales tax receipts. And then the purple line that mirrors it very closely is last fiscal year, 2019 and 19-20. The flat orange line is what we budgeted this year in sales tax if you just averaged it out. We don't know what it's going to be, but we said if it's $2.2 million a month on average, we'll meet our budget. And the teal bars are where we are actually coming in at every month. It's significantly higher than what we budgeted. In fact, it's pretty much higher every month than what we received in 2019. So sales tax comes and goes. You can see when you start getting close to Christmas, it goes up. The sales tax receipts for this year have really been phenomenal. So that leads me to a place to be able to make a recommendation to the commissioners. Because our goal is to get this $3.3 million that is in our capital plan to the school system, especially if we have it coming in because it is their money, is required by law to be spent on nothing but their capital needs. At this point, I'm recommending that, and there's a budget amendment in your packet that does these things. We would budget a one-time allocation of $1,050,000 to be paid to the school system that would come from this additional sales tax revenue. And then I would also recommend that we up the allocation monthly from $100,000 to $275,000 for the rest of the fiscal year. That will allow the school system, if you remember, they've already received $600,000. If we give them this one time $1,050,000, that puts them at $1,650,000. And if we go from $100,000 a month to $275,000 a month for the next 6 months, the rest of the fiscal year, that would give them their additional $1,650,000. That would put them at their total CIP funding, $3.3 million, according to our capital plan. I feel very comfortable that these sales tax revenues are coming in strong. I think the fact that the sales tax revenue, you know, we could still possibly take a hit, but these funds are specifically for the schools. We would have to take a traumatic nuclear hit to not be able to meet this plan. So I would recommend the commissioners consider the budget amendment that's in your packet and pass it and go ahead and get the funding to the school system. I think they have some plans for it. They would be able to use it for some additional safety measures and some other projects.
Correct. Safety is our number one goal, and this is the time of year we start planning for summer projects, so it would be a perfect time.
So I'd be happy to try to answer any questions, and I'm glad to have the school system here with us tonight to answer these questions. But I think this puts us back on target with our original plan, makes us consistent, and these funds are for the school system by law. So it's to me, it seems appropriate to go ahead and give it to them as the money's rolling in. So
I make a motion we approve that budget amendment.
I'll second.
Any discussion?
I just hope the public knows that this has nothing to do with all the COVID money, because that's a whole nother thing that has to go through. This is the normal stuff. So what a blessing. Thank you for being so smart with that line, you know?
Well, that graph, you know, sometimes it's hard to there's been so much uncertainty this year, but I really think that that graph helped me understand what's going on. And when you see, you know, how far above where we projected we are, it makes it a little easier to make these kind of decisions, I think.
We've been blessed.
Mm-hmm. If there's no further discussion, we have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Thank
you, Ms. Hagan. I think you're up again next.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas. So the next item is the board consideration by the board for extending coronavirus sick leave for our employees. And I've got the clicker. I was waiting on Bruce. So up until as of December 31st, we have been operating under the federal act, the Families First Coronavirus Response Act. And so this is a federal act. It expires the end of this calendar year. And what this federal act did was it allowed employees to be able to take up to 2 weeks of paid sick leave if they were sick with COVID or they were quarantined or isolated for COVID reasons. It also allowed for employees to take up to 2 weeks of emergency sick leave but they would only be paid at 2/3 of their regular salary to care for a dependent that had been quarantined or tested positive for COVID, or if they had a child that was out of school. And then there was a third piece to the federal act that allowed for 10 weeks of paid leave by employees, particularly for child care, but their salary would only be paid at 2/3 during that time. Well, the Families First Act is preparing to expire December 31st. It's not clear to me at this point what exactly the federal stimulus package may or may not do. I don't know yet. What I'm recommending the commissioners consider is enact this local benefit, which would be very similar to what the federal act did, unless the feds do something. The one caveat I would say is if you want to go forward with this, you could approve this plan with a caveat that if the federal government does something else through its stimulus package, we would abide by whatever the federal government puts together. My concern is they will not, or it won't be approved in time, or it may be months before they do this. So what I'm recommending is that from January 1st to June 30th, the county would offer very similar benefit to its employees. If employees would have access to 2 weeks of paid sick leave if they were sick with COVID or quarantine. They would have access to 2 weeks of paid sick leave, again, at the 2/3 salary, just like the federal act that's preparing to expire, if they had someone that they were taking care of, or even for child care. I'm not recommending that we extend the 10-week paid FMLA. I think the kids have been out of school for quite some time, and a lot of folks have made those arrangements, but at this point, if they had child care needs. So I'm only recommending that the local benefit, the one that would be done through us, would be for 2 weeks of paid sick for the employee, or if they're taking care of someone or a child for 2 weeks. And we believe this will continue to encourage employees to stay home. You know, if you got an employee that's out of sick leave, we don't want them worrying about, I don't have any more time, I need to go in, I shouldn't get to, no, go get tested, stay home, do what you need to do. We do have funding. We've been paying for this benefit from our coronavirus relief funds, and we have budgeted, as you remember, I think it was two meetings ago, we set up a budget for post-December 30th coronavirus relief funds. This is included in that, so we do have the funding to pay for this. We're based on how the costs have been up till this point, we're estimating $44,000 a month. So we estimate $264,000 a month from our post-December 30th coronavirus funding to take us from January 1st to June 30th. If come closer to June 30th, the feds have not done anything and we're still in the same boat we are now, we'll come back and talk about that at that time. But we feel like a six-month extension locally, if the federal government doesn't do something, is in our employees' best interest and the public's too. Frankly, we don't want folks coming to work sick. So, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to try to answer them. We also have Sherry here too. So, if you got any specific questions, we'll try to answer them.
And again, this would only go through the end of the fiscal year.
Yes, sir.
I'll make a motion to approve it.
A second.
Any discussion?
I just want to ask, if there is no COVID, that's not there. So if somebody gets sick and they have orthoscopic surgery and they're back in 5 days, their sick pay pays that, right?
That's right.
But in this case, COVID money pays it and not eat up their sick pay money.
That's correct.
Okay, yes. Great.
Good question.
It's like a fairy godmother.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's
COVID
it's,
fairy. I've right. never
it's
seen
it. It has to be COVID related quarantine tests. It is not for just any sick leave.
I bet smoke comes off y'all's ad machine because you're having to use it so much.
It's been a busy year, indeed.
Smart
indeed.
People.
Being no further discussion, do we have a motion? We have a motion. We have a second. Mm-hmm. No further discussion. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Again, unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Brian Baker, is he here?
Brian is joining us by Zoom, so I think, right. And we have...
75, we're going 75.
What's that?
We're on item number 75.
Yeah, the meeting times.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's exactly right. Thank you. All right. Ms. Gailey.
Yes.
You brought up an item we took off the consent agenda, the budget for this year. Brian, we're on hold for you. If you'll just hang on, please, sir. Ms. Gailey, would you like to address this issue?
Yes, I asked for this item to be added to the agenda, and I'm going to take off my mask for talking. It occurred to me that this might be an opportunity to talk about the timing or the time of the first meeting of the month of the Board of Commissioners. Traditionally, since 2012, it's been held at 9:00 in the morning. And I thought that this would be an opportunity for this new board to consider whether it wanted to move that meeting time for the first meeting of the month to 7 p.m. So you would have two 7 p.m. meetings each month instead of one at 9 in the morning and then one at 7 p.m. I thought one reason this would be a good time to talk about it is because this is, you know, my last meeting, and I've been serving for 4 years on this board. I have never missed a meeting. I have perfect attendance. I can't say that about many things in my life, but this was a big priority for me. So I feel like, you know, it hasn't, I have walked the walk, I have talked the talk, I have experienced how difficult it can be. And I think that, you know, it's an opportunity for the board to think about it. Also, nobody has asked me to change it. You know, none of you all asked me, brought it up, you didn't campaign on it. I thought this was a clean slate and a chance to rethink things and to maybe fix things to suit this board. The main thing that I think is that it might give the opportunity for more people to serve on the Board of Commissioners if they don't have to give up a half a day of work a month. And there are committees that the commissioners serve on that meet during the day. So, you know, you have to give up your time at other times during the month. And if this is one time that the Board of Commissioners could take away the, you know, the requirement that somebody commit that half a day a month, then it might make it possible for more people to be able to serve who might not otherwise be able to. I understand in the past this idea has come up and there's been concerns about people who wanted to attend the meeting, you know, members of the public who might not be able to come to an evening meeting, and this would give those people a chance to come to a morning meeting. But since the, you know, virus became a problem, we've seen that we can live stream meetings, other opportunities for people to participate with their public comments have come up. I think technology has really resolved that issue. So that's why I asked for this to be added to the agenda. I don't have a personal stake in it, and I don't, you know, if the board decides that they don't want to do that, you want to stick with the 9 in the morning meetings, then that's, you know, perfectly fine. I just thought that this was an opportunity to discuss it.
Well, I think it's great because Zoom is not going to be forever. I'm on the Governor's Crime Commission and Child Fatality Task Force in Raleigh. It will start meeting again in person, and that's during the day. And Billy and I have a work session at 12:30 for the school system, and I'm supportive of it.
7 o'clock
both times.
Mm-hmm. One thing I would like to note, look at page 2 of our proposal. It's in your packet, page 73. It talks about all meetings, regular meetings, being in the county commissioner's meeting room. And I know there are occasions where budget items, for example, and things of that sort, that we might want to have the luxury of being able to move it to a separate location. And I would recommend, regardless of what time we set this, that we commissioners be able to, in advance, with advance notice, be able to move the location to somewhere other than this room.
Well, in the past, you know, we've done that as time as it's been needed. You know, when it's time to do the budget, right, then there's discussion about what would be the best place to do it. And we tried to move around to different places. There was a time where it was done at Williams High School. And then we thought, well, hey, let's do it at a different high school to give people an opportunity to see more of the facilities, and especially some of the facilities needs. So we did it at Cummings 1 year. We did it at Southern 1 year. So that's something that the board can decide more. You don't have to set that at this time, you know, at the beginning of the year, you can kind of make that up as you go along.
I'm in agreement, but this specifically says meetings will be held.
Yeah, you can change that. That's not set in stone. You can change that. Just because it says that on your calendar doesn't mean that you can't change that later, right, Brian?
It doesn't. That sets this space as the regular space, and then it kicks in the requirement if we do move it. That starts making requiratory to post notices in advance. So if you approve it as it is, this is your regular space. You can change it at any time as long as we give adequate notice, but then the definition of change would be change from this space to any other space the commissioners would like to go to. So,
and a decision at one meeting would give us room to make that decision to, for example, tonight for the next, what would normally be the first meeting in January. We've had plenty of time to make a change in the location and meet the public notice requirements.
That's correct.
I assume Mr. Albright is on Zoom or...
Yes, he is.
I'd be concerned about... Yeah, this clearly says regular meetings shall be held. And in the law, shall and may have very different meanings. May means it could happen. Shall means it will happen. Mm-hmm. And that's my concern. It says shall be held in the commissioner's meeting room, second floor, office, and gives the address. I'd like that to be cleaned up at least. And I understand your interpretation. But I don't want there to be an issue and a challenge later because of the shall be held.
Well, you can simply, Mr. Chairman, you can simply add a phrase to the beginning of that sentence that says, subject to change by a vote of the board or by action of the board. This will be our schedule.
Right. And Mr. Albright, I totally agree and I appreciate that. With that amendment, I don't have an issue with this at all.
Well, I would make a motion that the 2021 regular meeting schedule be adopted with an amendment that, with the phraseology that Mr. Albright mentioned, subject to whatever he said, and the amendment of changing the regular meeting time of the first meeting of the month to 7 p.m. instead of 9 a.m. where there is a first Monday meeting of the month.
I think it's great, and I remember when y'all had budget meetings at the schools too, you have such a turnout. They may be a little temperate over taxes and stuff, but you know, that's government, that's what we do. And I think the more we can be in our community and folks meet us and really have conversations with us in person, the better. And we serve the people. I think it's a great idea.
Is that a second, or is that just
that's a second if that's what you want it to be? Absolutely.
Do we have any insight into any increase in our citizen participation after we went to a 9 o'clock meeting versus having previously had 7 p.m. meetings? Any insight at all in that?
We have not tracked that. I think we did for some time track the number of attendees we were having here. But I worked with John Payne on that for a couple of months, but I don't think it goes back very far. But I can talk with John and ask him, but I don't think we're going to have anything that we've maintained like attendance for any length of time that would help y'all make a decision based on that. I don't think so.
I think that also I don't know if they track how many people watch online. That for the past 10 months would be something different. Nine.
With further discussion, I assume we will continue to do Zoom meetings regardless of the COVID issue.
Yes, I think the live stream has been very popular. It seems to be working, and tonight we have a number of staff joining by Zoom. And what I would suggest to the commissioners is if you, whatever times you pick, if you go forward with 7 p.m., if a staff person is just presenting a budget amendment, which are usually pretty routine, especially if we know they're probably routine. I would suggest they continue to do it by Zoom. Mm-hmm. That way they don't necessarily have to come in, but they're there for the commissioners to ask any questions. If it's a potentially controversial budget amendment or some item, obviously we'd rather have them come in. But you know, a lot of the traffic and the business that the board does is oftentimes kind of routine. So we would continue to use Zoom to do that. If we continue through COVID, as many folks as we can have on Zoom, we'll try to do that too. So they're always available, but maybe not here physically. I think, Bruce, did you have a...
I was just going to say, because of what the judicial has to deal with COVID and having to utilize their space, you know, the morning sessions we have had difficulties with the spillover room, where the night meetings, we definitely have the spillover room for more participation, you know, public participation.
I totally agree about staff, because their day is 8 to 5 and ours starts at 7. So that's a long day for somebody, and I respect that. So Zoom is fine with me.
I think most staff have appreciated that ability. It's something that's reasonable to present to the commissioners via Zoom. And as long as the commissioners are comfortable with it, we will continue to do that. But if it's something big or controversial, or you know, we will certainly bring folks in physically.
Well, again, as Bruce, I think you're alluding to, with the 9 o'clock meetings and the judges wanting to have their courtrooms, the extra space is just not available. So that is a consideration. At the same time, as Ms. Thompson has indicated, staff members starting at 8 a.m. and then you're going to a 7 o'clock meeting, that's kind of, we have a lot that I think we as a board need to consider.
Well, of course, staff will, you know, staff serves at the pleasure of the commissioners and the public. So we're always going to work to try to make sure, if the commissioners have determined that it's in the public's interest to come in the evenings, that's when we will be here too, of course. So yeah, it's been over the past, since 2012, as Commissioner Gaylor mentioned, boards have made changes to this. So it's kind of been fluid. So it's very reasonable for you to consider this and change if you want to. And we will certainly adapt and go right on.
Any further discussion? Okay, motion second's already been placed. We have a motion. Let me note one thing, and I apologize for this. We are not, with this proposed calendar, having a first Monday meeting. So our first meeting pursuant to this calendar would be January the 19th. That normally would be the 18th of Monday. We have a holiday on the 18th, therefore it would be on the 19th. So our January 9 a.m. meeting is not impacted by this one way or the other. Okay.
I said that in my motion. I said in months correct, where there is a 9 a.m. meeting, it would be changed to 7 p.m.
Okay, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Nay. Okay, passes 4-1. Thank you.
Thank you for thinking of that, Amy.
Sure. Thank you for voting for it.
Now, I think we have Mr. Baker.
Yeah, I'm here by Zoom.
I just want to know where you bought that big tree out there. Did you cut that out there at your park? That Christmas tree behind you?
I am in my wife's office, so I'm not going to take credit for anything in here, including the purple shades behind me. I'm here tonight to discuss the Recreation and Parks Enabling Ordinance and some suggested changes we have to that ordinance. It's been about 20 years since we've made any changes here, so it was time. There's a fair amount of minor cleanup in here, but there are a few substantive items that I want to go over with you. Like all volunteer commissions we have at the county, it's a challenge to get people to be able to be at every single meeting. And so we have some challenges meeting a quorum and just getting full attendance at every single meeting. We do meet monthly. And that's just been a trouble over the years. So this change is going to address attendance issues and quorum issues and just get those cleaned up so that we can ensure when we ask volunteers to come out to our meetings, that we have enough people there to have a quorum, and that we can do the department's business. So what that looks like in the ordinance is increasing the number of board members from 7 to 9. That will allow some extra people to serve. We do have a fair amount of interest as far as members of the public who want to serve. So we'd be increasing the number of regular members from 7 to 9, and we would be changing the status of the two appointed members from regular members to ex officio members. So those two appointed members are one member of the Board of Commissioners and one member from the school system. They would still continue to be members and would still have voting privileges on the Recreation and Parks Commission. The difference would come in that those people are often very busy. As you guys know, you're very busy, and you can't always make a Recreation and Parks Commission meeting. In the event that happens, both of those seats would be counted as ex officio members, and they would not be counted against a quorum. So their attendance would not impact our ability to make a quorum and to have an official meeting. So again, those members still can come. They're still members of the commission. They still have voting rights when they come. But if they're not able to make it, we can still have a quorum and still do our regular business with the number of people we have there. And so that this change also establishes a quorum at 50% of our existing members. That was a little confusing in the ordinance as written. So we're changing that to a quorum is now 50% of the existing members of the commission. And those are really the substantive changes in this ordinance. Again, there's a few minor changes, but this is just a way to make sure that we don't have folks come out and not be able to have a meeting because we don't have a quorum. So I think this will address some of those issues that we have.
I'd like to state that I was, until being elected chairman, I was on the Recreation and Parks Board. And that has been a substantial issue at many meetings, particularly with school board and county commissioner members. I want a verification shake of heads that these new county commissioners are all going to attend your appointed assignments.
And some of yours,
thank
too.
Thank you.
And some of yours, too.
Exactly. So with that, Mr. Baker, I think your new county commissioner, I can't speak for the school board, I think they will be faithfully attending your meetings. But I highly recommend this change, having served on that board for many years. I know Ms. Thompson has been on that same board as well.
I agree, because you do great things and very important things, and you don't need people to stop your meeting, you know? So it's huge stuff that go on with Recreation Parks.
Yeah. I've also attended meetings where there was not a quorum, and therefore we could not conduct any business because of the numbers that did not show.
Yeah.
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion to second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. Passes.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. By the way, Mr. Baker has a law degree from Wake Forest University. I would like to acknowledge that. Thank you.
That's why stuff's in red. He knows what he's doing.
That's why I can't leave anything alone. That's because of that.
Okay. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is one of my absolute privileges, and I really look forward to recognizing Ms. Galey, who I'll say past chair, but only recently passed, and soon to be our North Carolina senator. You have the floor.
Oh. Well, thank you. So tonight's my last meeting, and I'm gonna take off my mask to talk. And I gave some thought to, the last 4 years and the things that I've learned, the things that I've had the opportunity to observe. And I wanted to call the public's attention to the hard work and the dedication of the county employees. It is remarkable to me, and it's been really my greatest honor and greatest privilege to be able to work with some of the finest professionals that you can imagine, who go above and beyond in service to this county, day in, day out, through good times and through times like COVID, just working so hard for the citizens, the taxpayers and the citizens, the residents of Alamance County. So I wanted to take a moment. We have an award that's given each quarter. It hasn't been done through COVID, called the SOAR Awards, which is to recognize employees who have done a great job. And I've gotten just a couple or few awards that have been given over the past couple years. And if you'll allow me to read these so that people can know what kind of wonderful people work for this county. The SOAR Awards is something that I've enjoyed attending and giving the awards to the people who are being recognized. Vice Chair Carter has done that with me as well, and it's wonderful. So one that was from the first quarter of fiscal year 2018-2019 was Cynthia Miller, who is a collection supervisor in the tax department. And so a citizen was so touched by the good work of the tax collector that they wanted to reach out. Cynthia Miller is my supervisor. Oh, this is a person who works there. Cynthia Miller is my supervisor, and I watch her go above and beyond every day at work. One situation stands out in particular. Cindy helped a taxpayer who is disabled and in need of our homestead exemption that helps reduce tax burden. Cindy went and picked up her paperwork from her home and delivered it to the necessary places in order to help facilitate the process. She truly cares about our taxpayers, and this is just one example of how she goes the extra mile beyond her duties every day. She exemplifies customer service as an excellent leader in our department. Another one who was recognized was Mark Dockery with the Alamance County Sheriff's Department in third quarter fiscal year 2018-2019. Mark recently created a software program that streams their radio channel, allowing multiple users with a link to access radio traffic. This feature runs over $6,000, and Mark was able to do it for $120. More importantly, this allows greater connectivity and communication between emergency services personnel. He felt that it was an important added feature that would benefit emergency services departments. His innovation and creativity should be recognized. I pulled some, and they're a little bit long. Jennifer Cole from Alamance County EMS, I remember this one in particular, was recognized for excellence during the fourth quarter of fiscal year 2017-2018. Jennifer is always going above and beyond her scope to help people. She responded to a wreck scene where it was an entire family and the vehicle was totaled. There were no injuries, but the family was not from around here and had nowhere to go. It was around lunchtime and there were some children with the parents. Jennifer was able to get them to shelter at a local restaurant and then found out they didn't have money for food. Being the respectful person she is, she asked the parents if they would mind if she bought their lunch. They agreed, and she was able to help them, and the children were very happy about it. To me, this is taking the extra step and really caring about what you do and how you treat people. And then the last one I wanted to share was Deanna Moore from Communications, Joshua Jordan from Communications, Lisa Raines, EMS, Kevin Ford, EMS, and Edward Thomas from EMS. They were recognized for excellence during the first quarter of fiscal year 2018-2019. My dad appeared to have an allergic reaction to something. I was at their house in about 10 minutes and the EMTs were already there. I saw a truck from Alamance County EMS, not the ambulance, and a truck from the North Central Volunteer Fire Department. They were marking the end of a long wooded driveway so that the other emergency vehicles could find them more easily. The EMTs gave Dad epinephrine injections and put him on oxygen. Within minutes, he was taken by Alamance to the ER. Everyone agrees that if Mom had tried to drive him to the hospital about 30 minutes away, he would have died. Everyone involved in his care at the house were so kind and concerned, but matter-of-fact and professional. I never had any doubt that my father was in very capable and competent hands. Please convey my thanks and gratitude to the people involved in saving my father's life. I'm so grateful. And that's the kind of people you have working for you, Alamance County. And I have learned so much. I feel like I'm well prepared for whatever, you know, the page is turned in a chapter in my life. I have learned so much from serving on the Department of Social Services Board, from attending school board meetings. It's been a real honor and a privilege, and I just thank the voters of Alamance County for allowing me the honor of serving them, and I thank the people of the county government for allowing me to represent them. So, thank you.
Ms. Gailey, would you join us at the podium?
And I have my children here tonight. I wanted to say that's Jack. Jack is 20. He's home from Appalachian. That's Sam. He's 18. He's a senior at Williams who's taken advantage of the opportunity to do the Career College and Promise program at ACC. And that's Mary, and she's home for Christmas. And she works in works on Capitol Hill for Congressman Tiffany from Wisconsin. So we're really proud of all three of our children.
And
thank you for being here.
And Ms. Gailey and Sheriff Johnson, please join me at the center right here.
To have all your kids at the same time is nothing less than a miracle.
Where am I supposed to be? Here?
Right where you are.
In the middle.
It's not.
It's been an honor to serve the sheriff for the last 4 years with you being our county commissioners. We've probably had the toughest times that I can remember in my 19 years as sheriff here. Mm-hmm. And we've weathered it so far, and a lot of it was because of you and your fellow commissioners. And we'll never forget you. I'll be seeing you in Raleigh when the sheriff says yes, he comes to town. And I will be very proud to call you my senator. And I want to present to you tonight, first of all, I'll give you the sheriff's cup of coffee. You're going to need it.
That's right.
And secondly, I hope you'll never forget the lives that were lost in 9/11. But here is three coins that there was only, I think, 1,000 of them made in the nation. Mm-hmm. And I want you to take these down and always remember, as you have here, the people come first.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Very nice.
In the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, I'd like to present to you an outstanding service and leadership award with a gavel.
Thank you.
And additionally, we have the Alamance County flag, which we're really, really pleased to give to you for all the years of service and personal leadership.
Thank you.
Thank you. Giving her a hug is not on camera for her hug. Well, I'm going to ask
you.
Brad might get you.
Of course, her kids didn't see that. So. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Thanks
we appreciate so you being here.
You got a great mom.
A lot for you all
to hear. Can I say one more thing?
Absolutely.
I would be terribly remiss if I did not thank Brian Haygood for working with me as chair for the past 3 years and commissioner for almost four. You became county manager, I think, in February of 2017, and we've done four budgets together, and it's just, it's been a delight and an honor. So thank
you. It's certainly been a pleasure and a privilege, and I know that the people have sent the right person to the Senate, and I would say that I have watched Commissioner Gailey as chair and commissioner give special attention to every constituent that ever called her. She brought every one of their needs to me or the appropriate staff person and followed through with it, and I know that we can look forward to that same amount of commitment when she goes to Raleigh. So
it's
been a real privilege. Thank you.
Thanks.
And thank you. We appreciate it.
I wanted to get a selfie. Can y'all? I wanted to get two selfies. All right.
Get the whole group
back. There we go.
And get too close.
Put your hand down, Steve. You put cover up here.
I'm smiling with my mask on.
Okay, I'll do one too. All right. Nice. And then one with these people.
Nice.
There we go. Okay, thank you. Perfect. I'm done now.
I do have one comment for family members. You do, now that she broke her camera, plan to give her a Christmas gift of a new
iPhone.
Okay. I think we have Andrea Rollins. Andrea, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, commissioners. I'm here today to request approval of a budget amendment that would increase our current elections department budget by $24,626.04. We were recently notified that there's grant funding. It's available from the state to provide a bonus of $19.56 per day for each election worker who works one-stop voting. The funds have already been received from the State Board of Elections. There's no local match required. I'd like to request approval of the budget amendment that will allow us to distribute these funds immediately.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
Our Board of Elections, we got the best around. That's all I'm going to say. Thank you, Kathy Holland, and your team.
Amen.
Absolutely. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Adrian Day, I think, is next. Is that correct?
It is.
That is correct. Good evening.
And the floor is yours.
Thank you. So I have two budget amendments. My first one is for our low-income energy assistance program. So we have received $253,295.67 from CARES Act fund. So we're just requesting to establish a budget line for these funds, and there is no county match.
Motion to approve.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Hey, Andrew, this is Pam. Your DSS is his own world. God bless all of you. But as someone in the general public, what's that money going to do? Because you guys have really had to be soldiers. So what does this do for DSS to be able to turn around and do for the public?
So this particular money that I'm asking for, this budget amendment, it is for funds where people last year received LEAP money. So it's really designated this time so that they will get an automatic payment to their heating source. But we do, in January, we will open up our LEAP program to the general public to apply. And that will, if eligible, they will receive either $200, $300, or $400 to their heating source.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Mm-mm. We have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries and it's unanimous. Thank you.
Okay. She got foster care.
Okay, so I have one for it.
Yes, ma'am. Continue, please.
Okay, this is our CARES Act foster care stipend funds. And earlier we received $37,000. However, this amount was based on the number of children who were in foster care in August. And when September came, we actually had three additional children who had entered foster care. And so this budget amendment is to include those $300 along with the $37,000 for those children. And there is no county match for this budget amendment as well.
Before you, can I ask her something?
Sure.
I just want to ask you one thing. As far as foster parents, I mean, kids are not going into foster care because they're going on vacation. It's a really, really bad situation. And I know you guys vet these folks really. I mean, we sometimes see horror stories. I mean, everything's got a horror story sometimes. And I'm just curious, how is the foster care parenting? How are we doing with having enough to really cover for the amount of young people that we're needing to put in a situation, temporary, however that may be? Are you seeing folks still staying loyal to that? Because, I mean, there are amazing people that take children into their homes. I mean, it's the most selfless thing you'll ever see. It's just amazing.
Yeah, I would agree, Commissioner Thompson. So for our younger children, our foster parents are very committed and dedicated to taking our younger children. We do find our teenagers are placed out of county quite a bit. And that's not new with COVID. That is just, I think you would find that in most communities. Foster parents are, they're just more ready, and they feel that they're more equipped to handle our younger children as opposed to our teenagers. But we have awesome foster parents who are always a call away. And I will tell you, some of them have been very committed to us in taking care of our teenagers short term.
Yeah, I know when serving on the Board of Education, Patsy Simpson, I used to tell her she needed to live in a shoe, because I don't know how many children she has raised, and I see the outcome in their lives, the difference she's made to all foster parents. That's a tremendous blessing. I encourage folks to get involved with that, because young people need solid homes. They're not coming from solid homes, and they really need that.
Absolutely, and we can always use foster homes here in Alamance County.
Any other comments? Do we have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Have a motion and second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries and is unanimous. We'd like to point out to the...
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. To the general public, these funds are not coming out of the county budget.
Right.
These are grants that are not our local money. Okay, public speakers, do we have any?
No, Mr. Chair, we do not.
All right. We'll move on to commissioners' responses to the new. We have commissioners' responses at this time. They do not have to be obviously related to what we've already done.
Awesome. I'll take a minute to say a few things. I just wanted to let the other commissioners know that I had the fortunate ability to sit into the school board meeting on Thursday evening. And when they were discussing, the board was discussing if we're going to get our children back in school. And by a majority vote of 4-3, they decided to let our kids go back to school on February 1st. And I think that is it's really good progress. I just wanted to let the school board know that we are glad that they have taken this vote and to get our students back in school. I would suggest anyone in the county who has students in school to go look at the numbers that Mr. Benson had showed the school board that shows our students are doing much worse in this environment. The number of F's and middle school and high school students has almost doubled year over year. Yeah. So it's really, really important. I'm very happy that our school board has taken this position to get our kids back in class. And I'm certain that the parents are happy as well. And I certainly hope that the school board will continue to look to the future, because we're not just raising children, we are raising adults. And we need to make sure that we have all the students that we have in the classrooms. Now we need to have more students in the classroom. And I'm just glad that the school board has taken this position going forward. I think it's a good sign of progress.
Oh my gosh, this is amazing.
Did you get my email on the resolution?
Ms. Thompson, do you have any comments?
I do. I just got to tell y'all, I went to the landfill 2 weeks ago. And I'm going to be one of those commissioners that pop in on all you amazing directors. And I'm not going to tell you when I'm coming because I don't want you to clean up your office. A clean office does not bother me. But that place is like its own city. I cannot give a big enough shout out to Richard Hill and that team out there. And they got me in that truck and I thought, I'll never be seen again. Because I saw, it's just amazing. Refrigerators, televisions, I mean, it's like its own city. And I went to the back up on this hill, and I'm going to tell you, there's no reason why anybody cannot get along, because seagulls and buzzards do not fly on the same days. They have got their routine with their skies. They alternate. So if they can do it, Congress can do it. But I just saw that thing, that big gazillion dollar costing thing that goes back and forth across. I will ride in that one day, not drive, but ride. That just blew my mind. And that is a gold mine for our county. What an example of excellent leadership and something that makes money and just something that we have to have. And it's crucial. And I'm just so proud of it. And Richard Hill knows every dime. I mean, he's amazing. Way he's just a jewel. And I also want to make a request, if I can, and John's going to help me with this. It's concerning the rock quarry area and the zoning we're looking at and zoning down there in the little snow camp village and all this. I really want us to somehow put some kind of halt, moratorium, that's a big word for me, whatever we have to do to protect that area right now until this zoning thing is in stone. Because if it ain't in stone, it's just waiting for something to happen. And Lord willing, we cannot let another something come in there on top of the quarry. And I mean, and I'm not going to put the quarry down because I got a gravel driveway, God bless them. But I don't want something else to slide in when it can happen. And it just can happen because it's been proven it has happened. And I don't want to see that happen again. And so these are citizens of our community. They're taxpayers. They have really went to bat for themselves. They fought long and hard for this. And I think our commissioners should stand up for them as well to keep that area safe as they see it with something else possibly coming in there while we're waiting on this. So that's kind of what I know to say, and it probably isn't right, and I'm going to let my John Paisley, the lawyer, kind of tell me what I really need to say.
I will when I get to my turn.
Okay. But I'm just so thankful to be here. It's just amazing. I'm Amy, you're so right. We're just the faces. We're up here doing the votes and the nodding, but we all know the people that really do the work are the ones on the ground, and this county is smoking hot, and I don't think anybody else has got anything on us. So I'm just so thankful.
Ms. Gailey?
The only thing I'd like to say is I would like to challenge the newspaper, both of them that report, you know, locally, to put that SOAR award stuff in your newspaper. That's a public record. Those are public documents. And there's no reason that, you know, maybe that's not clickbait. Is that going to sell newspapers? I think that the public should know more about the good job that county employees do for them. And I'm sure there's municipal employees who work really hard too. So I challenge our media, our local media, to put more effort into letting people know the good things that are happening in county government. That's it.
John, I forgot one thing. I'm so sorry. And I've just got to say, I sat in on a Zoom meeting with the health department, this guy right up here, brand new. Let's just get him. Holy cow. I felt like I was at the Pentagon. There were names, there were faces, there were people in places we don't even know. And they are amazing. I'm telling you something, Alamance County, we are ready
to administer our vaccine. I even volunteered to get mine here tonight, right in front of God and everybody. And I mean it. We don't need to worry. It is so well planned, and God, that is such a big deal. So just know your health department is on top of it. It's got great leadership and great people with him, and the team is just amazing. It just blew my mind. It was the biggest thing I've ever seen in my life. I'm just like so country, and that was just huge to me. So thank you so much.
Vice Chairman Carter.
Wow. You know, what a night. The information we've seen from our schools, stuff we saw in the Capitol meeting this week about what we're getting done in the county offices. I had to figure out how to use the new elevator tonight. I walked in and trying to find the buttons on the wall that used to be there. They're not there anymore. we're really moving some things forward that have been needed for a long time, and I'm really proud to say that we're all a part of that and can all be a part of that going forward. Amy, I've enjoyed working with you for the last 2 years. I'm going to really miss you, but I know you're going to be doing a great job for Alamance County and its citizens as you move into your work in Raleigh and the State Senate, and I know your family's going to be behind you. I've even talked to your husband about this, and I know he's going to be behind you too. So, Bill, to your comments about the schools, I have a grandson who's being not homeschooled, but remote taught at home with his grandmother, my wife. And I have to say clearly that she's the one doing that work, because I would not have a clue. I mean, it's only second grade, but trying to keep a second grader on track for about 8 hours a day is a full-time job, really. And so I'm really glad that we're going to be seeing the kids get back in school, and I'm glad that Tony's going to be over there taking care of it from the health department perspective to make sure we can manage all this. Yep. So I served on that board for 2 years as well, Tony. You've got a great crew there. I know the work of your contact tracers, and I know the work of your nurses. Second to none. We've got a really good team. And one of the things we're looking at, folks, is we've frozen positions last year as a part of the budget process. We froze positions in the sheriff's office. We froze positions in the health department and others. And it's time for us to step up. The money's coming in. We're going to have to get these people back on track to have what they need to get the job done to protect us. And I look forward to working with this board, because I know this board's going to do the right thing. Thank you all for what you do. The comments made tonight so far are right. It's not what we do. It's what the employees of Alamance County do. Thank you.
I know we've got to be conservative, and this board will be. At the same time, we've got to step up and do what's right for this county. Ms. Gailey, I really appreciate what you're doing. Driving to Raleigh every day is not something I would want to do. And we thank you for doing it and for everything that you've done for this board for the past 4 years. Just want to say thanks, and to your family. And I also know your husband very well, and was proud to campaign for you, particularly over in Guilford County. So we thank you. I also want to thank these two guys right here. One's not a guy, but I call everybody guys. They helped prepare me, and so did Miss Gailey, for what I'm doing here today. And it was a real pleasure. They make my job much, much easier, and I want to say thanks. As to Ms. Thompson's comments about the planning department, and as to those issues and snow camp and those issues particularly, we will have Ms. Gailey's replacement on our board, hopefully by the first meeting in February. And Ms. Thompson did contact me regarding that matter for this meeting, and I requested that we postpone that until the first meeting in February, because if we retrain the three new board members today, we'll have to do it all over again in February. So the attempt is to bring all the four new board members, myself, I know I served in 2014, but to bring me up to date and everybody else, this entire board, up to date. And then in February, we can put that on the agenda and have an introduction of what's going on and where we are as far as planning and so forth, and discuss that issue. So I want the general public to know we have not dropped the ball. We're not forgetting you guys and gals and so forth out there. Yeah, it will come back up, but we want to do it all inclusively with all the members that are on the board beginning in early February. Beyond that, everyone, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Do you have anything? Okay.
Yeah, we've got Brian coming up.
No.
You're up, but you're not up. I wasn't trying to leave you out. Okay, this says you have a fiscal update for 2020, but at this point you do not.
It's in the packet, but we covered the primary pieces of it during the school system. Sales tax is the big takeaway.
Excellent. Are there any other county commissioner comments?
Well, the only thing I would like to say is just wish everybody a happy New Year and a Merry Christmas, and just please remember what the season's all about. That's all I would ask. Just remember what the season's all about.
Any other comments? Merry Christmas. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
I second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.